welcome to Walker Tea Review. I'm Jason Walker here with a black tea from a familiar area, but one that you don't see offered quite as often. So I'm going to scoop out enough here, cover the bottom of my tasting cup here. I want to cover the bottom surface there, and so that means I just want a light sprinkle more. That looks good. When my water's been brought to an early boil, started to rumble. Not a full rolling boil, and I'm going to cover, I want enough water here to rise up just below my indentation there, which is going to serve as a kind of a spout pouring area. That looks good. Put the lid on. Talk about this in just a moment, the advantages of a tasting cup like this, or tasting set, for example. But before that, introduce this tea. I want to talk about, this is from TNT's. This is their Nilgiri Frost Tea. To find out the pricing and units being sold, you'll have to contact them, which has its inconveniences, but may have its advantages too. So you want to be able to contact them on their website there. This is from the Parkside Estate, which is in there in the Nilgiri Hills of India. Information about this tea also, you can find out on the product description, not necessarily the product page that might be specifically for prices and units, but the descriptions of Frost Tea that they're provided there. Their teas from this, from the Parkside Estate, are from the CR6017 cultivar, which is a China cultivar. Now, what happens with Frost Teas is that these are, as the name kind of suggests, teas that are affected by the frost that come January, February. There was a time when people just kind of tossed out this tea because it was considered damaged. But someone went ahead and processed it and said, this has some unique characteristics that are worth appreciating. And so a new market was developed for this particular type of tea, a frost tea. So I don't see as many frost teas offered on online retailers in the that you can access here in the U.S. So this is something that's a little bit more interesting to talk about. I'm going to talk about the dry leaf, the wet leaf, and the liquor here, starting off a bit with the dry. It's got note aromas similar to some that you will find with Darjeeling teas. Not that surprising, a lot of your Darjeeling teas are China cultivars, and that's what you have here as well, based on Chinese teas brought to India. You get a kind of a woody grapevine kind of aroma. You get a bit of a light kind of red, a red grape skin. If you peeled away the grape and just kind of chewed on the skin of those grapes, you'd get a little bit of that kind of grape skin type of aroma there. You also get a faint that rose type element that you can get in some of your Darjeelings, a dried rose flower. Those are the dominant. You might peel back a few more layers and get things like getting a bit more of a light allspice sweetness there as well. Scooping out and kind of looking at these leaves. These are, for the most part, leaf portions ranging in color from a pale olive green to a rust or chocolatey type brown. And then on to a bister, which is kind of a dark brown, black, dark gray type of color. So you get a range of colors there. I don't see a lot of tips or buds. I'm seeing segments of leaf, and a lot of these are kind of flat, maybe a little bit of folding, crinkling there, but not a lot because the portions of the leaf are quite small. Makes it tough to do that. Now, with a tasting set, you often get, I'm looking over here, let me reach over and get you, the tasting set comes with the lid, the cup here, and one moment. So let me get out the bowl that comes along. So what happens is with a bowl like this, you're able to look down in the liquor. You're able to taste from the cup either directly or dipping a spoon in. So the set would work such that you're able to rest the cup. If you had a row of these, you were tasting, say, a dozen or more teas, you're able to turn all these over fairly in sequence, fairly close in time, so that you're giving fairly even steeping times. You know, you're pouring your water in on in a series. You're decanting or in a series as well here. So that helps with a little bit more consistency. Now I'm going to let that. I'm going to actually transfer this to the pitcher so you can see the liquor here. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the wet leaf, starting with starting with a little smell here. Grape smells are still the dominant smell coming out right now. Still that kind of woody, wild grapevine smell. A sweet, moving over a bit towards more of a raisiny type smell coming off as well. Along with a bit of the raisin bran, toasted bran flake combined with the raisin, so you get the sweet raisin, you get the toastiness there. Again, a little bit of that woodiness or twigginess that I mentioned before from the wild grapevine. So a nice, rich aroma coming off there. To look at the leaves, you turn your cup upside down, give it a shake, and you're able to catch a lot of the leaves. Not all, because some of them will stick inside the cup there. But you're able to catch a lot of the leaves on the surface, inside there, bottom of your lid. And moving, and it's kind of poking around there, I get some stem pieces. I get, again, a little piece of, that's not tea. I get a piece of leaf portions here, various sizes, some quarter of an inch, some up to half an inch or an inch in length. Color-wise, you're getting still a little bit more consistent, a little bit more of a richer olive drab green color, moving over towards a bit of a rust red there. Again, no needles. Again, leaf portions, and that's the range of size looks a little bit more consistent in terms of leaf portion size than it did, say, in the dry leaf there. And the colors have become a little bit more narrow in band width in terms of olive drab to moving over to olive drab with rust type colors there. So I'm going to move on and talk about this liquor. And you get a nice kind of a coppery color there. Nice rich orange, red, brown color going. Give me that pour and a smell. Raisin bran notes still coming off. You still have that raisiny sweetness there, a bit of a toasty, woody bran flake kind of an aspect too. Give it a sip. Nice brightness in the cup. It's brightness in the sense of not murky, cloudy. Good vibrant color. Now, compared to other black teas, say Sri Lankan teas, say other Indian black teas, outside of Darjeeling, I'll put it in that way, like Assam's, for example. This one's got a lighter mouthfeel, so it's not harsh in astringency. It's not a brisk bite. It's got a nice, almost metallic type feel to it, or a mineral water kind of richness there. So it's not that intense. It's not harshly astringent. Yet it still has those aromas and flavors that you could smell in the liquor. So it's got that raisiny, raisin bran aspect that comes out in some of your bolder, brisker, and even harsher black teas, like some of those more intense Assams that are really designed or created to kind of welcome and go with milk, or might go as a nice brisk, refreshing iced tea. This one is smoother or milder, and so it's got again the mineral water type of mouthfeel, texture-wise. Aftertaste, you still get a light sense of that raisin bran, raisin sweetness, toastiness, but it's not accompanied with some of the harsher astringency that can often be found. It doesn't have as much now. Those more intense, like the Assams, they will have along with. They might have more of a molasses type of aftertaste. So it gets builds up a bit more sweetness with that briskness. This one doesn't offer that kind of intensity of aftertaste. So let me actually let this cool for just a moment, or now that it has cooled rather, let me give it one more shot and see what kind of changes, if any, have taken place. Yeah, it still has those brisker, bolder, punchier black tea kind of characteristics on the front, but they drop off very quickly in the back half of your tongue and your throat. So it gives a softer type of feel. This is one that I would not necessarily put with, let's say, a milk or even a sugar, because some of those characteristics might get overpowered or lost. Looking at this tea, it's a nice tea. It's one you might want to consider if you like some of the components of those bolder, stronger, say Assams or some of the Sri Lankan blacks. But don't go much for the more intense, you might say harsher aftertaste. This one has less of that. So, in the range of in that neighborhood, that realm of teas, this one's got some things going for it. I would give this one a 90. Nice components, ones that are familiar, comfortable, and rewarding, yet without some of that harshness that you may associate with it when these characters come with in other teas, so that you get a kind of an optimal best of both worlds, perhaps. Come back to Walker Tea Review to find teas that will give you the highlights that you're looking for, that may have fewer of the weaknesses that you've experienced in some of the teas in the past.